I'm a researcher at UC Santa Barbara. I'm getting my PhD there. And I work in a virtual reality sphere that we have there called the Allosphere, which you should all make the trip and go see. I will host you. It is a three-story virtual reality chamber. You walk in through the deck, through the bridge, and you can. It's immersive, real-time, interactive graphics, and surround audio. So you can look down, you can look up, you can look around. It's not a head-mounted display. You actually have, you know, kind of 40 other researchers on the lab with you. And my job there is content. Particularly, I do a lot of content to make the to use 3D to see things that you couldn't see, that are more difficult to see. So like 4D stuff or knots or things like that. So my byline that I've been putting around is that I put the N in n-dimensional, because that's what I've been doing with all of this algebra that I've been working on, which is called geometric algebra. Now, last year I talked in depth about an implementation that I did at compile time of this system of math. So I'm not going to do that again, although if you're really interested, we can go over what I've done so far. I'd love to sit with Louis and look at it at some point. But so today I wanted to talk a little bit about what the ideal would be in terms of bridging this geometric and functional designs together. And obviously we'll be elaborating on what I mean by that. The tagline for the talk used to be producing pure spaces. Now it's folding computed forms, because that's just where the talk went. I'm going to talk about, spend half the time on the first two and half the time on the second two, okay? I'm going to do a very, very lightweight, cursory, sort of naive implementation of these functional paradigms. And I'm going to do an overview of this geometric paradigm that I use. And I'm going to spend a lot of time talking about why it's worth everyone's time to spend 90 minutes here, okay? At the end of the last talk, there's always the, why are you doing this? I expect that again, but, the gentleman himself. So, here we go. I love this quote by Robert Rosen. Robert Rosen used category theory to classify what makes biological structure, what makes biological reality. You have to read this book. He wrote Anticipatory Systems, and then he wrote a book called Life Itself. I'm just going to let that quote sit there. Another quote that I like to talk to kind of frame what I'm trying to do is this Ron Reich quote, the obstacles of achieving a facile relationship of people and things seems to inhere not so much in the structure of things themselves as the structure of our ideas and values. And I want to lean on this point a little bit, because that's kind of the mapping that we're trying to do today, is to talk about structure of form and forms of structures, okay? So we're going to kind of find this duality between how functional programming structures forms and how geometric algebra forms the structures. Ron Reich was he did a lot of folding. He was an artist that sort of did a lot of folding techniques. This is the Vegreville egg. It's the first structure made with completely with computer assisted design. It's in Canada somewhere. Trust me, that is a historical fact. Or maybe don't trust me and confirm that. All right, so this is a lightweight version of what we're trying to do, right? The structure-function paradigm. And I work in trying to work in both ways. I'm trying to show that computation isn't just a way to implement a geometry, but that if you do it carefully enough, you find mirrors in it. They become not just metaphors, but models of what you're actually trying to create. So another way to think about it is we want to be careful in how we structure our functions, structure our morphisms in our code. And I believe that that is the way to make the best morphing structures, right? It's kind of a tautology, and yet there's a lot of details to work out and what this actually means. So my thesis and my PhD thesis is actually about this, and specifically I'm trying to, you know, delineate and delimit what is the computational processes to model in a constructive way folding processes. Okay? That's sort of where I'm coming from. So these are just a few iterations of some experiments that I've done with my geometric software to solve a folding problem. Does this have a laser pointer on it?
Yes. It's the little arrow, like line button in the middle.
Great, thanks. So if we have some sort of, piece of paper and we want to fold it down, there are multiple computational methods to do that. Some of them are pages of trigonometry, and I'm proposing a very constructivist construction approach. Kind of the same way that you solve problems with circle, with compass and ruler, we can solve problems with sphere and plane in 3D. Okay? So geometric algebra kind of allows us to build these constructive, universally constructible forms. Oops. Another type of the forms that I've been trying to make are complex spatial linkage mechanisms that open and close with one degree of freedom. These are networked Bennett mechanisms inspired by work of Yu and Chen. They wrote a book that designs some of these things. And again, I'm using a construction approach to generating the constraints to solve these problems and see what kinds of shapes can come out of them. Another sort of interesting duality is that in order to do these articulated movements that we call folds, we actually use a process called folding in computation. Where is that? How much of that is just an analogy and a metaphor, and how much of that is real? So I kind of want to pick that apart. So this is our computational folding. The current position depends on concatenating all your previous positions for a forward kinematics problem for calculating the position of a robot arm, for instance. So we have a joint here. Okay, fine. To figure out the joint here, we have to multiply it by this one, and we have to multiply the next one by the first two. So a mathematical folding operation, right? To create a folding motion. The third sort of overlap or analogy that I want to point out comes from the idea of computation itself, that space isn't necessarily something that we're just trying to measure or calculate, but space is something that we use to make our calculations, right? So this, again, sounds sort of obvious, but important to outline the history of it. Conrad Zuse's machines, or description of differential engines, his book actually translates to space which calculates, not just calculating space. And so, you know, the Babbage engine computing with gears, the ability to do a universal construction just with angles, similar to a universality theorem. You know, there is a linkage mechanism which signs your name. You know, so in the idea of how space works and the idea of how computation works, there's links, okay, in proof. There are certain things you can do just with folding operations to solve cubic equations that you can't do otherwise. And pushing quantum computing now is trying to figure out how electrons are braiding around each other to try to find out some sort of topological invariance in that. Okay, so again, we're still using space to calculate. All right, so if it's so important for calculation, how do we pose questions about space? When we talk about space, we want to use forms of space, show elements, circles and planes, and we want to put them in formulas that are well-formed. But there's two problems, right? There's the problem of articulating these complicated movements, and then there's also this problem of articulating these intricate concepts. So we, again, it's sort of this category work that I'm trying to do is to pull this apart. And lastly, you know, space has these etymologies in our language. To complicate is to fold, literally, and to evolve is to unroll or to unfold, literally. Okay, so why am I interested in geometric algebra in particular and functional programming in particular as this link? And it's because they share these amazing properties. I'm going to talk in a second about what I mean by coordinate-free and what I mean by point-free. But suffice it to say that we're trying to describe things in terms of algebraic calculations, right? So we don't want to think about x, y, z, and we don't want to think about our variables when we're composing logic, right? So we're trying to get our logic, to boil our logic, the variables, the arguments that go into our logic away from the way that we think. The covariance of the algebra, of the geometric algebra means that this is useful, for instance, in control theory. If you want to calculate some perturbation that's going to happen after you rotate something, well, what you can do is you can calculate the perturbation before you rotate it and then transform it. So basically what that means is doing a transformation on the product is the same as doing a product on the individual transformations. That's covariance, okay? The same covariant principle applies to in the functional world of design. Not necessarily in terms of that the order is, the order matters, but you can break things apart, okay? Whereas the geometric world that I work in is implicit, and you can define circles by 3 points by wedging them together. So these 3 points in the algebra define a circle in space. Similarly, functional approach is declarative. We have an n-dimensional mathematical system. We have a generic algorithmic system. One is really good at form. The other is really good at process. They're both universal constructions of relations with structure-preserving mappings. Okay. So the relationship is there. I mentioned point-free expressions, so I just want to say what's kind of like the general idea of what we're trying to do is height. We can define things recursively. Just to use Haskell notation. I'm not a Haskell programmer, trust me. Not that I wish I wasn't. Not that I wouldn't want to be. Never mind. Anyway, so but the idea is that you can replace this operation of taking a head and then doing something and then repeating it on the tail with something that just gets rid of the arguments and just says, look, a sum is a fold of something with some initializer, okay? So part of what I'm going to talk about today is just sort of building up with the very basic syntax of C++ how we get rid of head and tail when we want to do recursive algorithms, right? I said that was related to coordinate-free expressions in geometric algebra, and what I mean by that is I can specify the operation of a reflection without ever specifying x, y, or z. Okay? So I have just this expression which takes an input vector v and reflects it over the plane that n is normal to. Okay? And again, for those of you who want to pick my brain afterwards about the geometry itself, I'll go into it much more deeply, but this is a C++ conference, so I'm going to kind of gloss over this stuff. So the coordinate freeness and the n-dimensionality of the algebra allows me to write things like this in my code, which is a rotation that works in any dimension. Okay? There's some input plane that can be in any dimensional plane. And the return type is a plane plus a scalar value. It's called a multivector because it's mixed dimensions. And no matter what that dimension is, this will give us the operation that we can rotate something by. All right, so we can make all sorts of inside out tesseracts if you feed it a 4-dimensional, 5-dimensional, 6-dimensional thing. I have to shout out the people who actually invented the math, because I didn't. It starts with 1860s and William Clifford. Actually, starts before with Hermann Grassmann's extension algebra, extension calculus. And that has a very interesting legacy, because Grassmann's father was a biologist. So there was this idea of making a math of relationships. And so there was an attempt, Grassmann's time, to make this exterior algebra that was going to be a new universal foundation for math, in much the same way that category theory now is, potentially, right? So in the 1960s, David Huston is a physicist who was like, hey, wait a minute, you know, this stuff that we've kind of been ignoring is isomorphic to all these physical problems in space. And he wrote a space-time algebra with it, multivector calculus. There's gravity theories written in this language. It's kind of a unifying, universal way to describe space in any dimension, whether it's bent or not. Okay. So these are some of the applications. Classical mechanics, obviously, in physics, where it came from, robotics and kinematics, and this is sort of where I am at, the 3D computer graphics world. Although I work with people doing these other things, because it's a translating language, you know, I'm suddenly in a position where I can be like, you know, what is this five-dimensional space that's important to you? And what's the metric, and what do we need to do in order to model it? So I did this last year, but so I'm just going to gun through so you have a picture in your head about what actually this stuff that eventually I'm going to talk about is going to be applied to. But we basically have a notion of a coordinate system in space called bases. I want you to think about each one of these bases as a type. These are compile time types, and then these are coefficients or arguments, okay? So we don't need to worry about these today, the Greek letters, but the bases are what we are manipulating at the type level at compile time. And the reason we do that is because they combine in really interesting ways. So for instance, here are some more types. There's an E12 type, an E13, an E23. These are different types, okay? And they're basically, they represent different elements of space. So some are linear, some are lines, some are flat areas or planes. And one more in 3D space is E123. So you can see that in an n-dimensional space, there's 2 to n different basis types, okay? There's what we call the zero object, which is just a scalar value. And then there is a one blade, which are your one directional elements. And then there's a two blade and a three blade. Okay, those are the terms. And there's just, again, you don't need to know what this is at all, but these are just, I want to point out that there are some basic rules for how these things combine. Again, these are things that we work out at the compiler level. These two things are going to reduce to a zero object. These two will increase in grade. And there's a product that kind of combines both. Okay. These are going to be type computations. Officially, the types form a ring. Okay, so they can be added together and then they can multiply together. So there's two operations. And at least one's a group. So, you know, if you multiply one with the other, they'll eventually reduce to one of the other ones. Okay? And you end up, you know, if you were to expand an operation of a bunch of them, you end up getting all of these results, right? That the compiler's working out. So you end up generating something like that, right? You know, that's basically under the hood what's going on. We have some sort of index, some two inputs and some sort of indice into each. You can think of them as, you know, n dimensions of floats, and they get multiplied together, negated, whatever, to return a new list. So it's like a sparse matrix. And they, the basic construction is a product of two blades. So if you take represent a blade just as a short or an int, you can say that when you combine them, it's just an XOR. Okay, that's how you make a type. There's a few other rules about whether that is going to be legitimate, depending on which of those three operations we're doing. But this is the generic product type of two types. Okay, you have two types, and the product is this type. Enter. So at the end of the day, once you've done all that stuff or whatever, figured out, so once you've figured out all of your different bases and put them together in different ways at the compiler level, and you have, so what you end up having is a list of types, right? And these list of types actually represent geometric elements in closed implicit form. And that's really rare, okay? So for instance, this is a 5D space that we're in. There's a the 5D space is a map from a 3D space up to a 5D space using this conformal mapping. So if this A is a vector in 3D space, then this is just the origin vector. It's kind of homogenizing. And this is a weighted infinity. So basically, it's three types for x, y, and z, and two more types for the origin and the infinity, if you want to think about it as a list of types. So if you take those two things and do this operation on it, you have a representation of a pair of points in space, this point wedged with this point. And three of them, you have a circle. Four, a sphere. Again, closed form implicit calculations of geometric entities. And then you have all these other things like flat points, lines, dual versions of lines, because any geometric element has its dual representation. The sort of a canonical example is a pair of points. Okay, so this is a type. It's a pair of points. Its dual representation is, well, okay, let's imagine that those two points are antipodal points on a sphere. The dual representation is the equator of that sphere. So there's a circle, and then it's dual, which is two points. Okay. Lines also have dual representations. You can define a line as the wedge of two points and infinity. So two points make a point pair. You wedge those two with infinity, and you have a representation of a line. Or you can say a line is a direction and a point in space and some distance from the origin, right? So that's the difference between how you articulate a line versus a dual line. So these are just constructions. These actually wedge together too to form intersections. So for instance, you can take a sphere and wedge it with, this is the wedge operator, sorry, I keep saying that word, outer product. So you can take a sphere and wedge it with a plane, and you'll get the circle where they meet, okay? Algebraically, closed form, a really nice calculation that you can do is the intersection of two spheres, right? It's a hard thing to calculate with trigonometry, and especially in homogeneous space. Two spheres intersect, and you get the circle where they intersect. A lot of the solutions to these inverse kinematic problems are solved that way. You have two distance constraints. You have an unknown position. You have a point here and some radius sphere around it that you know that this point could be. Same with this one. You know this point. So you have a circle of possibilities for where this elbow joint could be, right? And then you constrain that with a plane, and you have two points where it could be. And then you pick one point, and you've closed form solved your kinematics equation. So those are just geometric objects. There's also geometric transformations that are incorporated into the algebra. I mentioned rotors before, but there's also all these other structure preserving mappings of objects. Okay. And again, if any of this intrigues you, I talk about this nonstop to anyone who'll listen. So my software, for instance, works like this. You know, you want to instantiate a three-dimensional Euclidean space, you would do something like that. Okay? You have an algebra, short for geometric algebra, because that's actually what it is, specified on some metric with some signature, positive signature, over some field. Okay? And the requirements for the field is that it needs to be a commutative ring. But it can be any field other than that. You usually only really specify this algebra over floats and doubles, although some people who really insist on doing it over complex numbers do that. But you don't need to. I mentioned this space-time algebra that David Heston has been working with. Well, this is how you would instantiate that algebra. Algebra metric. One signature that squares to one and three bases that square to negative one over some field. The five-dimensional space that I was just specifying is this. It's a 4-1 metric with the extra Boolean flag set to true so that I know to project everything into this conformal map. And then finally, some metrics that some physicists use to explore six-dimensional twister space, which I absolutely don't understand. Okay, but you could, in theory, use the algebra to work with it. Okay, so I gunned through that because I went into it a little more detail last year, and I don't want to. For those who were, you know, made the effort to come twice, I don't want to bore them. So. This is a generic question that I have. I solved this problem, right, of implementing this algebra using a lot of sort of whatever worked techniques at the template level. I saw Louis' talk last year and realized a lot of stuff I was doing I could make faster. So I made that faster. Doing a lot of conditional branching to not instantiate types that I didn't need to. But I want to really kind of go from the beginning and understand that these little basis blades are elements of a computation that I can work with and see what I can learn by treating them as formally as we treated structure of space. I want to treat the structure of process for calculating the space. So that means understanding whether these are monoidal, like what kind of categories these objects are, how they combine, what rules they undergo. So I've been trying to learn a little bit about category theory. I know very little about it. I'll be the first to admit that, but I've been reading about it. So I've been trying to think about how can we look at C++ and investigate some universal constructions for generating what we would need to do to make an algebra like this. Okay? And not just in doing so, not just make this particularly useful for space algebra, but make any algebra that anybody wants to do, like an initial algebra. So I want to sort of use half of the talk to. And if there's time, I'll go back and like kind of go into the details about the geometry, because I know I've gone through it. But I wanted to see what we could do with a few of the syntax tricks of C++ to try to build a universal construction. And I know very little about this, so that's why I entitled my thing Functional Programming, so I'd get the functional people in here to help. Okay. I've been reading this book that's interesting called The Semiotics of Programming. Has anyone read this? Did I bring it? I have the name here. I'll show the name of the author in a second. But what he talks about is the sort of three different ways to combine things. And these aren't going to necessarily be the most efficient. And If you use a much more expressive and complete library like HANA or something, you'll probably get a lot more out of it. So I'm not presenting a library. I just want to like gun into the C++ and be like, okay, so how would we, in the most natural way, just using what we know, try to build up some functional syntax at the template level that makes sense? And I'm glad I go before Louis this year, because like last year, I'm sure you're going to be like, do it this way. So, okay, so let's just say, let's imagine that our variadic template dot dot dots are streams, because there's like, you know, a bunch of them and they're coming in. And I'm also going to want to deal with something called a pair or a product, or just two things, right? And C++ 17, now we'll have something called a fold. Okay, so we can take something and just recursively iterate it without having to specify some sort of generic recursion algorithm for anything. So we have this sort of pure syntax for describing these three things. And the rest of the talk, I just want to put them together in different ways. Okay, and you can tell me whether at the end of the talk whether that was useful or not. And I think it is, but we'll see. So the this is the book I was mentioning, Tanaka Ishii's Semiotics of Programming, and he relates the lambda calculus to three different types of things. There's firstness, secondness, and thirdness, and he's talking about Charles Peirce's definitions of these. He's a philosopher, polymath, mathematician, in the turn of the century, and so the way Tanaka Ishii describes firstness is as variable. Okay, so we're in the template world, and we have a bunch of types that we say type name dot 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 xs, right? So those x's in this sort of mapping to this would be firstness. All right, they're just variables. Objects. Secondness is defined as a function on a variable. All right, so like a meta function would be secondness, or a pairing of two things. But usually it's a pairing that's a function and an argument. That would be secondness, right? And then he defines thirdness actually as in the lambda calculus, the fixed function, which I still don't really fully understand, but I will call, for the purposes of this talk, the folding function thirdness, because it's the closest I could find to fix that I understood. All right. So, and actually, I want some people to help me out with that later. But this is what we have for now. These are like sort of built into the semantics of the type, at least as of C++ 17. Maybe that will be. Or we could design it ourselves if we wanted to, but we want to try to build some sort of universal way of building things with just these things in the most general, most terse, most expressive way, okay? And that is something that I want to do, that because I want to be able to express my algebra that way, so that I can say this is the most terse, expressive, and generic way to describe space with the most generic, terse, and expressive way to describe computation, okay? So inherently, you know, I've been working on this briefly, so this is to generate conversation. A lot of disclaimers, so I'm just going to stop. All right. So I'm going to talk about arrows first, because when I was doing all of these combinatorics at compile time, I had to keep track of which indices were coming together, which ones were being annihilated, which ones I needed to eliminate, and I had this sort of massive stack of I have still a massive stack of templates that remember which index they came from, so that when it came time to make a function, I could call them in. Oh, my computer is not plugged in. That would be my fault.
Thank you.
in focus. Well, I mean, are people clear about what I'm about to try to do or what we've done so far? Yeah.
That last thing you said about keeping track of indices, I didn't really catch.
Okay, yeah. I tend to not ever describe that very well. It's a personal note. There's a representation of this algebra that's on a basis, like there's a vector basis, say, you know, E1, E2, E3, right? So a vector has three of those, and it will have three indices, 0, 1, and 2, right, that refer to those bases, right? So if I multiply that vector by another vector, I'll actually get a zero object, a scalar value, and three new types, E1, 2, E1, 3, and E2, 3, which represent sort of the plane in between those things. That's how the algebra works. So I have a new type, right? I have four indices into that type that need to be filled in and evaluated, and the combinatorics work in this weird combo switching mechanism that I need to, when I evaluate which ones contribute to which one, I need to keep track so that when I make my function vec A times vec B, the compiler knows, okay, grab 0 from vec A and 0 from vec B and add that, start summing that into 0 of the result, the 0 index of the result. And then I need to do the same for one of each, and then do the same for two of each, and then I have my dot product calculated, right? But I had to keep track of which index from the two input vectors they came from, and the same for the other ones. The rest of that's kind of like a cross product. So I need 0 from vec A and 3 from vec B to be multiplied and summed in, plus the other ones to be multiplied and summed in. So which indices I pull from depends on the logic of the algebra, which is generated at compile time so that it's efficient. So that's what I mean by keeping track of the indices. Like when I actually call evaluate, or when I actually make this function called, you know, make this type with these actual arguments at runtime, I've generated sort of an instruction template. I don't even know what to call it. I think I want to start calling it an arrow, because it's basically this signal. It tells you which combos to pull from to generate. So it's like, it's what I'm going to talk about arrows, because you grab the first, you grab the second, you pass it through, you pull it down. It's sort of like a combinatoric stream process. That combinatoric stream process is a type, right? Not in the current implementation. I would like it to, and I'd love help with that, actually. I'd like it to. I do not know the laws of arrow, so you're going to have to help us with that one today, too, David. All right. Oh, gosh. Yeah, my battery is, like, non-existent, so... It's cool. We have lots of time because I spoke really fast about geometric algebra. Oh, it's here. You know what? Since I have it open, let me just show you real quick what I mean. So if I...
Can you make it bigger, please?
Yeah. All right, perfect. All right, so I showed slides of these instantiating these algebras, right? You can nest algebras inside other ones. I didn't really want to talk about that. So what this little program prints out is In the algebra EGA, from its types, which I also instantiate at compile time, from its types of vector, print the basis for that vector. Right? I mean, these are all compile time types. And then I can also, so far I've just been calling it an arrow to keep a mnemonic in my mind that this computation is, that's what I want to eventually map to arrows, even though this is not really an arrow. Here I print out the instructions for multiplying one quaternion by another quaternion, basically. One rotor by another. And then I do the same thing here. I'm going to print out the instructions for multiplying the one-dimensional grade of the space-time algebra by the one-dimensional grade of the space-time algebra. So multiplying two space-time vectors together. What are the combinatorics for that? So if I run this algebra, and then I have basis elements for my CGA, the conformal geometric algebra, points, pairs, circles, and spheres. So let's just make that. All right, so it generated all those algebras, or it's generating them. So that took a little while, but you know, it generated a six-dimensional algebra, a five-dimensional algebra, a four-dimensional algebra, you know. So these are the bases of a sphere object. All right, they're encoded in bit form. So this is a short, basically. It could be an unsigned char. And the flags that are on represent the bases that are represented in the blade. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. This representation is not my own. It's Daniel Fontaine's. He discovered this sort of product of two bases as the XOR. And then the instructions that were printed out are up here. So two rotors, two quaternions in Euclidean 3D space, if I multiply two together, the result is going to actually also be a quaternion. And the way you're going to calculate it is you're going to grab the third elements of the first one and the second one, minus these, minus those, and that's your, that's all your new zero index, right? Okay, so this is compile time combinatorics. That's what's going on. And then here is product of vectors A and B in twister algebra, right? And there, you know, the reasons why we do this at compile time is for efficiency. That's it. You could do it at runtime with with checking the grades and stuff, but it will run slow.
So you do this at compile time, and then you can use these rules to actually do the computation. Is that
exactly? And then you do the rules to do the computation at runtime. Yeah.
So just to make sure I understand, but if you do it, you generate basically you generate a function, okay? And like in the case of the quaternion multiplication. You basically generate a function, and then you just feed in the quaternions, and the function is as if
evaluated.
Written it by hand.
Exactly. Exactly. Okay, I'm sorry. The question is, is it done this way? And the answer is yes. No. The question is, just generate the rules for the function at compile time, and then at runtime that. Those rules are evaluated? And the answer is yes. I'll show you in the current, actually, I like doing this stuff. So I'll show you the examples. Where is my detail browser? Who knows where it is? Execution lists instructions, maybe? These are all of my index insert of remove craziness, right? A not type to find the difference between two types. I went into all of this stuff last year, so I'm not going to go into it, but I want to find where the execution list is actually called. Okay, so here we go. This is an execution list. Each element of this list is one of those little A0 times B0. That's like a token, right? That gets calculated and put into the execution list. And then when the execution list is called, this is how it works right now. You get you get an input, this is runtime, a rotor, say, a quaternion, and another quaternion. And class R has been figured out at compile time. And it returns an R where the first executable is this, which is the token plus all the rest of the tokens for that zero element, comma, the rest of the executables, dot, 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 right? So that's a binary function. There's also unary functions for flipping. There's other things that happen, right? But this is like the sort of the meat of it. So what ends up being made is this execution list is actually a nested, right? So it's an execution list of execution lists, one per each resulting index. And, you know, that's just the way it worked. But I can't, you know, I would love to generalize this. It works fast right now because I don't need to worry about heterogeneous types. My types are shorts, you know? So when I, yeah, is that?
If you're only using shorts, then couldn't you use just constexpr computation instead of type-based computation?
But the problem is that some of the question is, if I'm just using shorts to calculate, because the bases are represented as shorts, okay, right? So that's the bases are represented as shorts. So the question is, because I'm just using shorts, can I just use const expression to evaluate this instead of doing this nested type level stuff? And I would love to figure out how to do that. I tried doing a bunch of stuff with at the list level, but I always at the sort of compile time stretched out list of initializer list level type of thing, but I never got far enough because I kept running into the problem of not being able to generate a type out of the result. Like, how do I?
Yeah. Be able to use
that's what I'm saying. I try to use std array. I'll sit with you. It's hard for me to generate a type that's a circle because I'll have a list, but the list is std array. How do I make a type out of? Can I make a type out of that? That's different from a. Well, I don't know if I can. If I can make a type out of a std array that has certain things versus a std array that has other things, then I guess it could work.
If you have constexpr std arrays, you can.
Okay.
They have to be constexpr where you generate the type. But let's just.
All right. Well, let's take it there. Oh, okay. So I gotta get my slides back up.
Hello. No, this slide never loaded. It's a nice slide. Too big. All right. These are some of the forms I make with the algebra. I guess I put too many on it, so you can't see it. I'll show it to you. Yeah, exactly. Okay, great. Skip that slide because it's crashing the entire thing. Okay.
All right, so I've been paying attention to arrows just because I like the name. Let's be honest. I thought that was kind of what I felt like I was doing because I was telling the compiler where to pull things from, right? I was kind of constructing a computation. And the more I read about arrows, that's what the arrows are for, structuring, building computation in an expressive way. So I was like, well, I'll learn about them. And I read these papers, and I have to say they were complicated. Although there was one that sort of explained that it's good for parser. So I was like, okay, that's exactly what I'm looking for. And then there was another one that said that it's good for signal processing. And I'm like, okay, that's not really what I'm looking for, but maybe that's cool. I was like, let's just go for it and see where we get. Let's talk about arrows. What's an arrow in template metaprogramming world? You know, what's the sort of naive way to implement it? And where can it take us? And we're not going to get as far as generating this combinatorics with that. I'm not going to do it today, but I'm going to build up as much as I can, and you can tell me whether I wasted my time. There's also this arrow calculus, that's if you want to look at some strange letters. But basically, I was hoping that it would help me organize this where these indices are from, pulling streams, stuff like that. All right, so in the Haskell world, what I've gathered so far is that there is three combinators that basically define an arrow that are important. One basically lifts some generic function into the notion of an arrow. There's another one called pipe, which once those things have been lifted, connects the output of one into the input of another. And then the last thing that I think is what makes it kind of different from this notion of a monad, which is that it can select a stream versus another stream. I hope this doesn't make sense to everyone because I went through some time instantiating this in template metaprogramming world so that it would. Okay, so if you're already with me, then the rest is. So here's this is just like a motivating example because I started rewriting the code and I was like, all right, I have two vec3s. I'm going to need to multiply them together, right? So I need a distributive thing, right? And the way I used to do it was I have a product. And then these subproducts, product of two things, well, you distribute it. So then there's the first element of the list times these, then the second element times these, and the third times that. So you have to have this product that recurses to this some subproduct. And the subproduct, each time passing the head and tail, the subproduct is actually what evaluates the thing.
Could you go back to the previous slide real quick?
So there's some. It's a check to see whether we're at the end. If it's an empty set, right? If we're at the end, we're done. The first is just going to calculate a subproduct of A on all of B, and then the rest is going to do recurse back to the product with the rest of A, passing in B again. It's a naive, bad way to do it, right? And then I concatenate those things.
So why would you do that as opposed to computing the sums first before computing the products?
These are product type sums. So they're like, it's A and B and C. These don't collapse. Each one of these things is a type, right?
You mean A or B or C?
In the algebra, I get confused with the functional product types. I mean that it's. The question is, what exactly do I mean? These are three different types that are basically a list of three different types, like three different ints. So I don't know what that maps to in the functional paradigm. Would it be a product? So it's a combination of types into a list, basically, compile time list. I don't know how that maps. Yeah?
I'm just wondering.
Yeah. So this is like E1, E2, E3. Okay. I should have written that. There's no coefficients going on right now. This is just, I'm just trying to figure out what type I'm going to get out when I multiply these things together.
Okay. So that's more normal form, the thing on the right, and the thing on the left?
This is the thing on the right, you mean?
Yeah.
Is more normal than this? What do you mean by more normal?
I guess I'm just trying to wrap my head around what this plus thing means, because I'm convinced myself that I don't know what it means.
You missed the first slides. Yeah. There was basically the way in geometric algebra, the way that we say that something is a vector, we don't say x comma y comma z. That's not our vector. Our vector is the coefficient of x plus the coefficient of y plus the coefficient of z. It's like a linear equation. So that when we distribute so that it can distribute over multiplication, right? So we say E1 plus E2 plus E3. But that's a code. There's going to be a difference between the syntax of the algebra and the syntax of... But it's good to be careful there, yeah, because like, this is an OR operation in your world, right? Yeah.
So your A, B, and C, are they scalars or
types.
Okay, so they're basis vectors too.
Yeah.
And they D, E, F too.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. There's no scalars involved.
Okay.
Except for the basis vector that represents the zero object, which is one, which is represents the notion of a scalar, but isn't a scalar. There's no values yet. We're at type level. And there won't be values for the rest of the talk. There's no values in this talk. Okay, let me just say, it's one of the reasons why I wanted to start is like there will be, except for that when I say I need to grab that zero or grab that one, when I say that, I'm talking about some runtime variable that I want to grab, which is a float, okay? But from here on out, no values.
It's a talk without value.
It's a talk without value. It's a pointless talk without value. You like that one? All right, so here we go. So then the subproduct evaluates, kind of recurses in, and we get the same problem that we don't like, which is the thing that's actually the most important thing to evaluate is buried in the code. All right, no problem. 30 minutes. Okay, so we could use the HANA library, right? So I started messing around with this because I think it's brilliant what you've done. And so I have a geometric product, which is an XOR. And I can lift it into this meta function, and then I'd have this returns my basis of 0, 1s, and 2s are based on bits. So this is a E1, E2, and E3 because it's bit shifted. It's a bad notation. Somebody last year said I should use user defined literals, and I'm like, yeah, I want to code that. But and then. The result would be the application of this lifted geometric product onto Louis tuples, and then I apply vecfec. Okay, that's compile time distributed multiplication, and what I would get is all the different ways that they combine. But what I don't get necessarily, I don't know how to do, is reduce it into. I have to reduce the list, order it, and that's my new type. But also, I want to remember I need to keep track of which elements of these combine to get the result. So there's like this, there's this middle area. I need arrows basically to keep track of. I think I need arrows to keep track of. Maybe I'm wrong about that. I just said it. Maybe I do want arrows to keep track of which indices. This is the thing. This is the code I showed you. I have an execution list, a computation instruction, an A, and a B, and I have indices from where it came from. I end up templating that. And I have this reminder here because people forget why they're confused at this point in the talk is because it's fast. We want to do this, okay? All right, so let's just, I'm sure there's a way to do this in your library, and I just want to like go from the basics and try to figure out what's going on here. So let's imagine we have two lists, okay? That's basically what we have when we have the A plus B plus C and D plus E plus F. Those are two lists, right, of types. And so what we could do is, well, we want to expand them each at a time. We can expand all of these for each one of these. So this expands our argument. What do you call a template argument? Yeah, the right template argument, and then evaluates this sum function that I haven't defined yet, and then this calls that again. So this gets called for every one of these. Does this make sense? Okay. And this will return all the pairs of x's and y's. It's kind of a full-on application, so I'll get the distributed product. All right, so basically what we've done, I think, you guys can correct me if I'm wrong, is we've taken, what the partial application does is it takes a binary product of two things and turns it into just a function that takes one thing and the return is lifted. Or this is a notation that I've read and I think that's what's going on when we do that, Oops. Let me do this. So we have some meta function that takes some number of arguments, and then we have almost all the arguments, but not quite, minus one. And then when we call evaluate, we send it that last one, and it's evaluated, right? That's what I'm calling the arrow. That's what we're taking a function of some number of arguments, and we're lifting it into a version that is eventually just going to be evaluated.
So,
yeah. Objections.
Normally, in the exposition I've seen of arrows, the ARR function takes in a function from A to B and returns some kind of container or parameterized on type A and type B.
Yeah, maybe I'm redefining them. I mean, I'm kind of using the, okay, the question is, normally arrows are defined as taking a function from A to B and returning some
container
parameterized on type A and type B, which is sort of what I'm trying to do, because I want a function parameterized that, I want a function that, no, it returns, it takes a function that that takes in an A and returns a B, right? So I need a function that takes in one element and spits out one element. I have a function that takes in too many elements. So it's kind of, I just need to curry it. Yeah?
To me, this looks like partial application of meta
function. Yeah, it's a partial application of meta function. That's all it is. I'm just like, for now I'm saying like, let's, we can make objections as to whether this is not going to hold the universal property of arrows, but I was inspired by arrows to follow this logic. Let's just see where it takes us. So just hold on for a second, okay?
Not trying to object. I'm trying to understand what you got here.
Yeah. Me too.
How it relates to arrows.
Yeah, and maybe it doesn't in any way. I mean, maybe it doesn't. Maybe it shouldn't be called arrows. Maybe it should just be called partial application function juggling. Okay. Let's just for the purposes of this enclosed safe space, we'll just call it an arrow, okay?
You know,
for the record, I'm not sure if this is correct, okay? So yeah, that's what we're gonna do. We're just gonna say, we're going to take some function with one element to partially apply it. Okay, so we're going to say pair whatever you're going to evaluate me with later, pair me with zero. Okay, so pair me with these guys is going to return all of them paired with zero. Okay, since that seems to be useful, we'll just call that thing a stream. We'll call the arrow a process, and we'll just pass a stream of process and evaluate a bunch of things. So that way we can, you know, say distribute the way that we want to. This is going to make, I think, do I have a dot 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 missing? I might.
Excess is never expanded.
Yeah, thank you. So there should be a dot 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 bracket for it to expand excess. Right, we just saw this before. This is the slide before. But it gives us all the pairs. All right, so this is what I'm going to call a pipe. Again, perhaps a misnomer, so I have to clarify these. But I'm going to call a pipe something that takes two processes and feeds the output of one to the input of the other one. OK? That's what I'm going to call my Aspen C++ Now 2015 encapsulated pipe. Room Berta, okay? First is gonna take some process, arrow, and evaluate, it's gonna assume that the incoming evaluation is a pair, and it's gonna apply the process to the first and pass through the second. So this takes in a pair and returns a pair. Okay, so let's just see them in action. So we can pair, take something that we're just going to pair with 0. So we call that a pair with 0. We have a successor function, which I'll show you in a second. So we're lifting a successor function into the notion of an arrow. And then we're going to pipe pair with 0 into, so that this, we're going to have a function that pairs something with 0 and then adds 1 to the first thing. So if we do stream process of a bunch of these, it's going to pair all of these with 0 and add 1 to the first element. Right? OK, so this is the successor function. It just takes some sort of sequential type thing and adds whatever its unit value is and returns that. Right, so eval. So we have some notion of something that's can be sequenced, can be iterated over, and we have some way to evaluate the next one. So this will get fed some sort of int, which we do here. So these elements are fed into this function when we call add1. All right, so I just call it split and to do something that takes a takes one thing and evaluates two processes over it and returns a pair of both of those things evaluated. So in the arrow notation, it's sort of the version equivalent of and, right? And finally, parallel, which takes two arrows and takes a pair and applies evaluation to the first element of the pair and the other one to the second element of the pair. All right, that's basically it for arrows. That's sort of like a very lightweight, totally not official version of arrows. Okay, that is encapsulated version of arrows. The encapsulated version of very simple secondness, right? Moving functions to functions in template metaprogramming, right? Most basic way. So now we have this thing fold. So far what we can really do is take things in, maybe split them, add things to the first one, and then we get a bunch of stuff at the output, right? But we want to do a little more than that. Otherwise, I have been wasting everyone's time. So let's take stock of what we've been doing. We have these things called lists, and we have so far, and then we have these things called pairs, which are like when we have an input pair, we'll take one, do one thing to the first part, do something to the second part, because we're not really where we want to be yet. So I'm hoping maybe we can do something with this notion of the fold in C++ 17. Where is that going to take us? So it's like a binary operation that's just nested. So we take a type. It seems to only operate on values, so I have to do this. I can't just, you know, that's fine. I think that that's actually good. But note the brackets. So I kind of make this into a thing, a value, sort of a value, not a type anymore. I call the operand dot, dot, dot. And what that does is it calls this plus the next one, and then it calls plus on the result, and then plus on the result. It's a fold. So if I did fold on all these, I'd get 3. Okay, let's just see what else we can do with it. We can make a simple filter, for instance. We could say, we're going to take some sort of arrow, and we're going to evaluate something, and we're going to do plus on dot, dot, dot. We're going to fold a list. And what we're going to do is we're going to define this operator differently for whatever types that we're messing around with so that it makes sense to us. So a plus operator on list is just going to concatenate the list. So here we've done plus dot, dot, dot on some filtering process that spits out a filtered list, filtered stream. Yeah.
So what if you have an empty list?
I don't know. If there's an empty list, sorry, where? If one of these is empty?
So you're saying there's a special plus operator.
Yeah, plus an empty list just returns nothing. The concatenation of nothing just returns the same list. I mean, that's dealt with in the list meta thing. Yeah.
With C++17 operators, since you're using plus, I think if you have an empty parameter back, and then you try to, you know, use the default operator with plus, it's going to default to zero. If you use like or, it would default to false. Yeah. And if you use the and, it would default to true.
That's right.
I think that's is this your question?
Yeah, basically, because I mean, you have the special plus operator, which makes sense on lists, and that's always like tied with a zero.
I hear you.
So that would be a monoid is like the
majority
fold stuff.
Yes, exactly.
So I was just looking for the...
So there needs to be an initial... So the question is, you know, what happens in the case that this is a zero, an initial object in a monoidal category, right? So that it's like a zero thing. I make sure that whatever the monoidal category is knows what to do in that case, right?
Well, these are generic, right?
Well, list is...
So filter is like a bad... Oh, okay. Never mind. Okay, so this is just for hand lists. It's not arbitrary.
No, this is just like, I'm saying like make a filter on a list. This is not totally generic. This is just playing. Okay. So imagine that this process function was this, remove.
Right.
And it looks to see whether these things are the same. And if they are the same, it makes an initial object, and if not, it returns the thing. So if I call filter lift remove with I want to remove this element from this list, I'll get 2, 3, right? Simple filter. Just it processes a stream as it comes in and returns either the initial object or not. We could figure out a way to generalize it into something more appropriate. You know, this is programmed in one piece of paper. So what about pairs? What's the equivalent for pairs? Now, maybe there's a better operator than plus for this. But so I was just thinking, okay, well, let's just think about pairs as being, remember that I'm going to be folding these things. So I'm going to think about them as coming in. I like the stream metaphor, so I'm going to think about pairs as coming in. So I'm going to think about a pair as having an object up here and another object down here. All right, and so the operation for the next pair is I'm going to do a pairwise sum. So I'm going to take the first one up here and add it, and then I'm going to add these two together. That's just sort of the most generic thing you can do. And there's other ones that we can do too, but this is the one I'm going to start with. And it calls decal type because these might be other things that have their own folding operation plus, right? So if these are ints, these will fold down to some sum. If they're pairs, they'll do something else. If they're pairs, actually, they're going to nest, right? Because a pair will return a pair. So let's call some folding operation like a sync, right? So we have some process that's going to evaluate and fold, and here we're going to take a pairing, and we're going to I don't say what I'm pairing this with. Oh yeah, sorry, I'd missed this bracket. So 3 and 5 are each going to pair with 1. So I'm going to have 1 and 3 and 1 and 5, and then I'm going to sum those. So I'll have 2 and 8, right? That's sort of, I'm calling it a sync because it's just pulling everything down into one object, like a pooling. So my terminology is a little loose.
So sync does a fold.
Mm-hmm.
And you're folding down the...
I have a pairing. I have a partial application of a pairing, right? And then I have my inputs. So my inputs are 3 and 5. And each one of those I'm going to pair with 1, and I'm going to sync that. So I'm going to have a pairing of 1 and 3 and a pairing of 1 and 5, and I'm going to sync that, and I'll get a 2 and an 8. Right?
So is that almost like map? Are we mapping this?
Yeah, well, but
to the 3 and to the 5?
We're mapping, we're applying it, sure. Yeah, it's going to be like a mapping.
It's like binding the first argument.
Yeah, it's extends to bind. Okay, but there's something missing. There's a problem, right? Because we can only, because of the folding expressions, the way it works, we can only, we evaluate this arrow stream and then fold, right? We don't have a way to like get into the process of folding itself and do something. So that's a problem. But maybe we can take arrows and put them into the stream. I thought about that, so we'll get that out in a second. And then also, I still haven't been able to keep track of my computation results, which is what I want to do. If I do sync, this stuff just boils down, and I don't know where I got in the process. I needed an equivalent of scan, right, that can boil things down but also remember the process that it underwent as it boiled it down. So scan actually bothered me for a while. So I came up with a slightly different fold operator for pair. Different operator. Actually, this won't work. You have to use less than equals. I'm not sure why. What this one does, this is interesting. This is interesting. It takes two pairs. It takes the first argument and of each and does what we did before to them, just makes a sum. And then it just extends the incoming one. This is the operator that should be there. And then I'm going to do a left fold. Okay? So I'm pumping things into the leftmost operator. And what you end up getting is a sort of scan. It's sort of something close to a scan, right? We have some pair, say I have an arrow that pairs whatever it comes into with void, okay? So we have a pairing with void. Let's look at this one, actually. This is more. So there's a sync left and a sync right, and they obviously do slightly different things. So we have a pairing with void, and then we have our inputs. So what happens is one gets put in here, and then it gets sunk into that other type of stream that sums and nests at the same time. So now we're summing and also keeping track of where we've been. So it's kind of like an impulse train, which is what I wanted. I wanted to be able to send the same signal and accumulate the results, but remember them. We're still not where I want to be, which is this nice index sorting that happens really fast at compile time. But look at, I mean, these are all the, I haven't done any sorting, but these are all the things that I have to do to do efficient sorting at compile time. All these cases. All right. Finally, this is work in progress. I haven't quite done a proof of concept of this one yet. But once we have those nested things, we want to be able to unfold them again into a stream. So I think of the pairs as this folded thing, and I want to think of these guys as an unfolding. So what if we found some sort of pattern that takes the first of some ID and pipes that into the second, and then we can repeat that pattern. Here it doesn't really work because there's no parameter pack to unfold. This overloads the operator for pipes. So the pipe plus another pipe will give us the pipe, the two pipes piped. Two piper pipes. So maybe we could, instead of pairing something with void, we could pair something with a pipe, and when that gets folded in, then that operation gets folded in. Maybe there's a way to do some sort of computation at that level. That's as far as I got. So just a quick summary as to where I've just been, again, I've just been trying to construct with sort of the tools at hand in the syntax of the language, trying to build something without, trying to build something that's point free. Okay? So I like this notion of the pairs and whatever notion of arrows. They seem to have some sort of duality, especially because the pairs also can, when you fold them, they can consider only the first arguments and ignore the second, the same way that a pipe, the same way that first can in arrows. So there's something going on there, which is interesting to me. They can be used for folding and unfolding, we think. I think we can fold arrows in an interesting way, maybe. There's a lot missing from this universal construction, but I have no idea what. So we could talk about what we could do for fold to make it better. If I keep nesting these pairs, is my compile time going to increase? Maybe. Maybe folding. Maybe pairs have some sort of way of navigating them easier. I don't know. There's another basis for the algebras that's based on a spectral notion. So maybe I can do that instead of keeping track of XORs. And has this all been, you know, point free in the right way, or has it been? Oh, is it a way? Is it just a mute exercise? So that's what we've done, and we have 5 minutes for questions. Got it?
The basis of the whole thing is just being able to construct a tensor algebra out of two algebras.
Yeah.
And use it for exterior forms, but it also applies when you have free algebras from either finitely or finitely generated algebra.
Yeah.
I didn't see that aspect actually well emphasized. Because
you
take, when you look at only the tensor algebra point of view, you only have those structures
that work. Yeah, it's a great point. So the point is that if the idea is to be able to have an initial algebra that you can then turn into any other algebra, we're not even close to that, and that's absolutely true. I needed to start with some way of finding how to make a construction that isn't just based on geometric algebra. So that's absolutely correct. Yeah?
So, sorry, I was back from lunch a bit late and missed the first few slides.
It's okay, you can go back.
But I wanted to commend you for trying to, you know, you know, fight through these intellectual challenges and stuff, because you know, that's how we make progress in the end.
Yeah, it's like a thought experiment, right?
I mean, you know, not every investigation leads to success, but it's very interesting. I did remind me a lot of the earlier work, and I think you might be aware of this book because you mentioned Daniel Fontaine.
Yeah.
Who's one of the authors of it. I had a book, Geometric Algebra for Computer Science.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that book basically guided this the original implementation.
I was thinking
the one that I'm trying to generalize. No, I mean, he invented this entire bit representation of blades, and it's brilliant. And there is another algebra out there. Sorry, another implementation called Galette, which is a geometric algebra expressions template library. Also written in C++. I haven't been able to compile it yet, but I'm sure that's my fault. And it's somewhat similar. That makes expression templates at compile time. And then there's other, but there's not that many implementations of it. Yeah. Cool. Well, thanks, everybody.